Very obvious answer if I ask you the question, have you ever been startled in your life? Every one of us have been startled. And give you one instance of one of my sons, who will be nameless, but he's just gone out of the room, who was startled one night, or in the early hours of the morning, because in his sleep, he'd gotten himself out of bed, and the boys had a bunk bed, well, they still have actually, and he'd gone the other side of the cage part, as it were, and he was standing in a narrow gap between the radiator and the bed, and he was trapped. And he obviously banged himself, hurt himself, and he woke up. And he was startled. And he started to scream. And of course that woke us, and we had to go in and attend to him and calm him down. Being startled is something that I'm sure happens quite often to all of us. Often it's someone appearing when you don't expect them to appear. Here we read of shepherds who are hardy men, hardy souls. They're used to fighting lions and bears, wolves, and these sort of creatures. Read of King David before, when he was a shepherd, fighting with such, taking his sling and having to slay them. They had experienced, I'm sure, a very hard life. Were hard out on the fields at night. But nothing they had experienced would prepare them for what they are about to see and to experience now. As an angel comes and appears before them. An angel from the realms of glory. We read in verse 9. The shepherds were out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks at night, when an angel of the Lord appeared to them. This is a magnificent sight. Don't ever think of just, I don't know how you picture an angel in your mind when you read of or think of an angel sent from heaven. But this is not something that is just like an ordinary appearance of some kind of person looking like a man. If you turn to Ezekiel chapter 1, which again is in page 1286 black Bibles, 587 red Bibles. When you turn to Ezekiel in chapter 1, there is this man, Ezekiel, and there he is on his own, when suddenly angels from the realms of glory appear to him. And listen to what the description of these angels. He says, I looked and I saw a windstorm coming out of the north, an immense cloud with flashing lightning and surrounded by brilliant light. The centre of the fire looked like glowing metal. And then the fire was what looked like four living creatures. In appearance, their form was that of a man. But each of them had four faces and four wings. Their legs were straight, their feet were like those of a calf and gleamed like burnished bronze. Under their wings and on their four sides, they had the hands of a man. All four of them had faces and wings, and their wings touched one another. Each one went straight ahead and did not turn around as they moved. Now listen to this. Their faces looked like this. Each of the four had the face of a man. And on each of the right, and on the right side, each had the face of a lion. And on the left, the face of an ox. Each also had the face of an eagle. Now, why are we told these things? Quite clear reason for being told these things, that the face of a man is to bring to us the fact that these angelic beings have the intelligence that we have. Only far, far superior. Think of a whole classroom filled with Einsteins. You begin to understand something of the concept of the intelligence of an angelic being. But each of them also had the face of a lion. And you think of the courage and the power, the fearlessness of a lion, and think of a whole pack of lions, and you begin to get a picture of something of what it is like to behold an angel from the realms of glory. And then each of them has a face of an ox. You think of the old days when the ox pulled the plough, great, strong, mighty beast that can pull, it would seem, almost anything. Well, think of a whole herd, if I guess that's the word, isn't it? A whole herd of oxes. And you begin to get something of an imagination, the idea of the strength of an ox. And then of an eagle. You think of the sharpness of the eagle's eye that right up from high can see right down to something minute to swoop down upon its prey. You get the speed as well there, don't you? But you think of the eye and you think of the angelic beings and the power that they have to be able to see things beyond what the human eye can conceive. That gives us something of the sense of these angelic beings, or this angelic being that has come before the shepherds at this point. But it displays something else when this angel comes. It says in verse 9 of Luke, when the angel appeared to them, the glory of the Lord shone around them. It's a display of God's majesty comes with these angels. And the shepherds who see this are filled with awe. They're filled with fear. They're filled with dread. You can read in Scripture other times when angelic beings have shown something of their power and their strength and their might and their glory to man. The consequence has been that the man has fallen on his face as to worship and has had to be told by the angel, "Though you think I'm something incredible, do not worship me. Do not worship me. I'm but a messenger." Doesn't that tell us something of the majesty and the might and the glory of God? These giants from heaven are indeed the servants of man. God sends the angels to minister to mankind. And here, whilst these shepherds are out watching their flocks by night, they are coming to render their greatest ever service. They are coming to proclaim the most remarkable event ever. And this is what he says in verse 10. "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." Angels must come and proclaim this most wonderful news. But who do they appear to? Now, they don't appear to the worldly great. They don't appear to the kings and the princes and the rich and the influential and the powerful, the mighty emperors of the world. But they appear to shepherds. And in the time of writing, in the time of the birth, shepherds are amongst the lowliest of peoples. They're not highly esteemed. And yet, the angels come and appear to them. Very apt as well, isn't it, that when you think Israel's first true king, Israel's greatest king in a sense in the Old Testament, David was a shepherd. David was a shepherd taken from the flock to be the king of Israel. And we sung in that last hymn, "Thou key of David come and open wide our heavenly home." David was a king, but now the one the angels come to proclaim to the shepherds who is coming to the world is the King of Kings. Very apt that they come to shepherds, but also it reminds us that Christ has come for the lowly, for the weak, for the nothing people of this world, for those who are downcast, for those who are outcast, for those who feel their worthlessness. "This will be the sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." We sing and we think about him being born in a stable. Don't know for sure if it was truly a stable in the way we understand a stable, or whether it was just some poor room, as it were, that animals were in as well as a family living in, because some lived in that kind of poverty. Doesn't matter. What matters is the fact that he was laid in a manger, and that tells us There was no king's bedroom for him. There was no gold at his birth that had to come, didn't it, from the kings. There was none of these things. And he was laid in a feeding trough for animals, that all the world may feed on him, may have life through him. And so he comes even to the lowly. But then as the announcement is made, this announcement by the angel must be accompanied by praise. God cannot allow such a proclamation, the greatest proclamation in a sense that has ever taken place. He cannot allow it without there be praise. And the angels themselves, God would have to restrain them. But he doesn't. Because you read in verse 13, suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God. And the idea of the great company is, think of an army. Think of an army. Think of an army appearing. Each one in that army greater than a whole company of Rambos. We've already seen that, haven't we, with the description from Ezekiel. Think of that army standing there on the hillside. Think of the light that accompanies them. This didn't happen at the creation. You don't read at the creation of a whole company of angels marvelling at what God did. They did marvel, but you don't read of such things. And you don't read anywhere else in Scripture of a whole multitude of angels in that way coming to proclaim anything from God. Angels come, angels speak, but this is the only time you read such glorious things at the birth of Christ. And what do? Firstly, they praise God's glory. We read in verse 14, glory to God in the highest. And with these words, with this scene, we have a little window, don't we? A window that the curtains peel back. And we see into heaven. We see something of the glory that is going on unceasingly in heaven, even as we speak. We might say, in glory in heaven, every day is Christmas Day. Always, those angelic beings are praising God. And as history is unfolding in this world that we live in, God's works, as they've been displayed, as they've taken forth, angels in heaven have been praising him, have been glorifying him. But this birth, the birth of the Son of God, is more glorious than anything else God has ever done. And so, if it were possible, the angels are praising him more than they've ever done. The Son of God has taken on humanity. The Lord of the universe, the creator and the sustainer of the universe, the one whom angels worship, has become one with us. That is what we're here for this morning. I haven't got tinsel round me, but if I had, someone has, if I had tinsel round me, well, that's nice, that's fine. I'm getting into it all. But what's really important is the reason behind it all. Why we're here this morning is that Christ, the Son of God, has become the Son of Man in order that we might become sons of God. He's become one with us. Angels themselves can scarcely believe it. They can scarcely believe that this is the way God would save his people. And when they say, glory to God in the highest, it's no rehearsed nativity. They haven't gone countless times over these things to get their words right or how they would look, how they should stand. And there's no jealousy in their hearts. No anything of self. There's just a hearts. Their hearts are filled with adoration. And to those angels, to those angelic beings, Christ is all. And from the depth of their being, with every ounce of their energy, they want to praise God and say, glory to God in the highest. Because this is the most monumental event. And therefore, their praise is all the greater. So they praise God's glory, but then what do? The next words we read, they praise God's peace. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to men. Jesus, we read in that passage in Isaiah, one of the titles given to the Son of God when he would come into this world was Prince of Peace. Prince of Peace. We like to think, we like to talk, and we hear much said about how Jesus came to bring peace on earth, peace to mankind. And philosophers sit back and they muse and they say, well, yes, it's a very high ideal, a very noble ideal, very high ideal. And I don't know if you're aware, but recently some letters have been unveiled that talk about World War I. And you know, I'm sure, if you don't, let me tell you, in World War I, the first Christmas, in the trenches, on Christmas Eve, about 7:30 in the evening, the Germans started to light candles and started to sing. And then they shouted to the English, or to the British, should include the Welsh and the Scots, shouldn't I, and the Irish. They shouted to our side, as it were. They said, here's a challenge. Will any of you come over and share a bottle of wine? And one man did, and he took over a large cake. And as a consequence of all of this, they got out the trenches. And they met in no man's land. And they exchanged caps, and they exchanged badges, and various other gifts. And they sang, and they had a service. And they got some of their bully beef cans, and they kicked them around. They used their hats, their steel helmets, as goalposts, and they had a football match. 1966, and all that before its time. Don't know if we won 4-2. And this went on. Peace. Peace. In the trenches until 3 o'clock on Christmas Day, a German officer, what are you doing? Something like that. And called back his men. And that was the end of the peace. And we look at all the pieces in the world, all the pieces that people have ever tried to bring, peace that is, not pieces as in bits and bobs, all the peace that people have tried to bring, and we see the failings. And so the philosopher says, your high ideal, O Christian, your high ideal, Jesus, impossible. It's impossible. The wickedness of mankind is too great. What do you say, O Christian? What do you say? You say, too great? The wickedness of man too great? Too great for Almighty God? What nonsense. But you see, people talk of peace, and they think the peace that's being spoken of here is a peace in terms of end of hostilities, end of warfare. Men shaking hands with men. Full stop. End of story. It's all about talking of wars ending. But that talk of that peace is to miss the mark, is to miss what the Bible is proclaiming. Because the Bible itself tells us, and Jesus himself says, that not until the end of this age will there be an end of wars. In fact, Jesus himself says, as the age, we're in this last age, as this age draws to its close, as it comes near its end, wars will increase. Wars and hostilities will increase on the face of the earth. But sadly and tragically, up and down the country today, men in pulpits and, even more sadly, women in pulpits are proclaiming a different kind of peace. They're proclaiming a peace that talks about warfare and such things. And it's a kind of, let's cross our fingers and let's hope. If you play cricket, you can imagine someone practicing bowling and they can spin. But the problem is every time they spin, the ball which is going dead straight towards the wicket suddenly veers off. And every time they do it, it either veers off to the left or it veers off to the right. They cannot hit the wicket because it spins away. And many Christian people, or people who would call themselves Christian, would talk about a peace that starts off looking right, but then it spins off. Because it doesn't hit the mark. It doesn't talk about the real peace that these angels came to proclaim. People say, ah, peace, peace, where there is no peace. The Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ, his whole purpose in coming was not to bring peace between man and man, although that is a consequence. He came to bring peace between Almighty God and man. And also the Bible proclaims that peace between Almighty God and man is found only in Christ alone. The Bible tells us that we are in the most impossible condition imaginable. The Bible tells us that we are all hurtling like an asteroid through space to an eternity where we will have to stand before God. That the day is coming where we will have to appear before him. And God that time, Christ, whom we will appear before, will not be the gentle baby in the manger, the one you could rock. He will be the terrifying judge of the whole earth. That is our problem. That is where we fail to have any peace, is between us and God. And all the wars and all those things, that's a consequence. If you would like to, turn in your Bibles to Matthew. If you don't, I'll read it anyway. But turn in your Bibles to Matthew 25. 1542, Black Bibles. 702, Red Bibles. Matthew 25, where you read in verse 31, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, that's not the birth in the manger, that's not Christmas Day, that's Judgment Day. That's the end of the age day. When the Son of Man comes then, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. Come to heaven. Come to heaven. Go down, verse 41. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. At that time, you will stand before him, and every thought, every whispered word, every forgotten action will be emblazoned before you, together with, from your heart, the very depths of your heart, the deepest conviction, the deepest awareness you can imagine of your sinfulness, of your vileness, of your inability to stand. Knees may knock, knees will knock, knees will tremble. And then the sentence will be passed. The sentence will be eternal. Eternal separation, eternal regret. And the person who receives that sentence would cry out, oh, for a moment of time that I might call upon Jesus. But the damning words will come back. Too late. Too late. Too late. But let me come to some wonderful news. The whole reason why we're here, the whole reason why we want to sing carols at this time of the year, the whole reason we want to sing hymns at any time of the year. You see, the third thing to say is that we too may praise. We too may praise God. Jesus came into this world to offer peace. He came into this world to offer reconciliation. We are all fallen in sin. All of us. But Christ came because God loves us. Christ came to bring reconciliation. Not just at Christmas time. And his blood that was going to be shed upon the cross at Calvary, his blood is what makes it all possible. Because his blood is the price that God demands for sin to be removed. And unless his blood covers you, you can know nothing of these things. You can know them up here. But unless his blood covers the sins in your heart, then that judgment day will come all too quickly. We read in that verse 14, peace to men on whom his favour rests. And what that means is on whom his favour rests. Well, we might all experience a measure of peace in this life, but what it's really talking about there is the peace with God. Of having your sins taken away, of having them washed, of being cleansed, of being a new person. Then his peace rests on you. His favour rests on you. His grace is upon you. When you can truly say, he did these things for me. When you can truly say, his blood has cleansed me. When you can truly say, I've repented of my sins. I've asked him to save me. Then something wonderful begins to happen. And I don't know if it's wonderful in your heart this morning, but I pray Almighty God that it would be. Because you see, before that can happen, there has to be a measure of torment. There may even be a measure of antagonism. There may even be a measure of, why is this bloke standing up here telling me I'm so bad for? I don't want to hear this nonsense. Who's he to say such things? I'm nobody, but I speak on the authority of God. Before you can see these things, there must be a measure of torment. You must see your sinfulness. You must see the emptiness of your own vain efforts to get right with God. And you must come to him, believing in Christ, and repenting towards God of all your sins. And then there's something wonderful that happens, begins to happen, is that you start to hear the Christmas angels. Their great glad tidings tell. And your own heart wells up as you hear these things. No longer is it just about the music. No longer is it the nostalgia of a forgotten childhood that's remembered every Christmas. No longer is it the lovely setting, the winter wonderland. Now, the whole reason you want to sing is because it's about the Son of God. And you've seen him, the one who is from eternity, the only saviour of men. And you want to cry with your whole being, and oh, that I could, with my whole being, cry, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You want to join all the glorious host. If that's your heart, if that's your heart this morning, even an incy wincy bit, our hearts go cold, don't they? But if that's your heart this morning, what a glorious future. What a glorious future is yours. Now you are called a peacemaker. But the peacemakers that we are to be is not to say, no, no, don't hit him, although that applies. But we're to be peacemakers in the sense that we have the message that brings peace, the gospel, the good news. We're to go forth and to tell people about Jesus Christ and how he came into this world to save sinners. That's our job. It's something we should delight in. We're peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, they shall see God. Ah, there we come to the glorious future, you see. You shall see God, my eyes shall behold him. And you will join the greatest choir. And now, you begin to do what you're created to do, which is to glorify God. Now you begin it, and I would urge you, and I would exhort you, do it. Do it. Do it this Christmas day. Do it. Do it leading up to the end of the year. Do it next year. Do it throughout the time that you have there, here on this earth. Till he returns or calls you home. Then You will do it forever.